What's up, guys? Frank here with Lajon Witherspoon of the one and only Sevendust, celebrating the band's 14th studio album, Truth Killer, coming this July. Lajon, thank you so much for taking the time to hang with me today. You know, I mean, 14 records under your belt and a lifetime of accolades. You know, I imagine you really, I know actually that you spent a lot, if not all of your time into the band. I mean, you guys average an album every other year since you started, which is far quicker than I think, you know, any band that I speak to. That said, you know, does the songwriting, do you think that comes easy to Sevendust, or do you find that you guys beat yourself up to kind of make these restraints work?
No, what a good question. No, it doesn't. It's not hard. Well, think about it like this. What a good question. I come from a band with all these guys that have grown up together, but we all come from different backgrounds, but kind of in the same. So everyone's a writer in my band, and it's very cool to be able to be in a band where we're not afraid to show each other our ideas, because I think another thing is we've been together for so long, and there's not one guy that's like, well, everything comes from my point of view, and I'm the singer, and it has to be my way. Now, that's stupid. We're 50-something-year-old men, and we know each other more than anybody. And one thing that I think has kept us together for this long and is we split everything evenly. And that's a very important thing, I feel, with bands. And I think a lot of people lose that joy within the band. Because if you think about it, if you got one guy pulling up in a Lamborghini and a guy flying in a helicopter, and this dude over here just rolled on a skateboard, not because he wanted to, just because he can't afford to even have a Toyota, which is not a bad car to have because I've had them. But you know what I'm saying? It just doesn't make, you can't go in a writing session or being in a, I feel like those are groups that do that. We're a band. You know what I mean? We've been through life, death, divorce, marriage, babies, oh God, girlfriends, whatever you want to call it. We've been there together when your dad died and we're together on the road and we can't get you back home. Who's there to take care of that? Who's there to comfort that? These guys that have been together in this band, that's why I feel like this is, we're so strong. And, you know, we get mad at each other, of course, and like, that guy's a douchebag today, and, you know, but we get over it, you know, but that's brothers. And I feel very blessed to be in this opportunity with this band and have gone for this long. I said it when we first started that we were going to be a band that's destined to do this. And I remember saying, man, wouldn't it be crazy to the guys if we were growing up and we had kids and wives and we could have our kids on the tour bus and have our families on the tour bus. We've done all that stuff. My wife looks at me right now and says, I'll never get on that damn tour bus with you again. So it's like, she was back in the day, she'd be in the bunk with me all happy, cuddled up. Now it's like, can I get my own bunk? Who's smoking a cigarette in the back lounge? I'm like, what happened to my dream?
Right. It's grown up.
We've grown up, man. But man, think it's been an incredible journey for me as a 50-year-old man to now look out and see these other 50-year-old men that I've grown up with, but now I know their kids and I know their kids' kids. And it's like, it's not a regular show. I don't call Sevendust shows concerts or family reunions to me. It's like a family reunion. And I like saying that, man. And I think everyone understands when I say that. That's what a Sevendust show is.
That's amazing. I mean, I was going to dabble in that. I mean, like, it's thoroughly impressive that, you know, with the exception of a quick stint you did with Sonny Mayo, you guys have relatively...
Sonny, love Sonny. He's great.
You have kept the same lineup since the start, which is, like, really unheard of these days, where everybody feels like, oh, everybody's replaceable, right? But, yeah, you know, you guys have this certain secret to you to keep it together after 30 years. And I mean, that said, would you attribute it? Not just, I mean, it sounds like you splice everything evenly, which is great, but I'm sure that there's something more to it.
It's a certain, it's the method behind us being together. It's that chemistry, for sure. It's that chemistry that we have together. It's the chemistry that when we go in a room, and it's like this last album, Truth Killer, we got to really do something special by recording several songs at the farmhouse, which I was telling you about. And what a crazy, it made me feel like a kid being in the band when we're in this beautiful setting, view, sunrise going, sunrise coming up. But all of a sudden you have Sevendust set up in grandma's bedroom, which is a new bed in there and everything, but this is still grandma's bedroom. Everything's remote. But you have Morgan's drum set, John's guitar, Vinny's bass, and then Clint, because he's not doing guitar right now because we're recording these, behind a desk that I've made up in a computer. It is a full-on studio, but I'm looking at it. I'm like, this is grandma's bedroom, and Sevendust is in there writing Sevendust songs, laughing, telling jokes, cooking out. And it was so surreal, and I felt like it made these songs even more important, just with that energy that was behind it. And I remember one night, we moved the stuff over to record in the front bedroom, and the sunset was going down. And this is a long country road, and my family, Ashley's family, there's only two houses here, and then one house here, and cows everywhere. And I remember walking in the front window when it was open and seeing Vinny and John, because they were right there at the window, and they were set up. Clint's computers are right there, and they were rocking out bass and guitar tracks just right in the front window. And I was like, wouldn't it be crazy if anyone knew what we were doing right now in this house, like just creating music that's, you know, that we've been doing for years, but it was just something special. And we were able to take that energy over to Elvis Bassett's beautiful house. So we went from the small country farmhouse to the big mansion with the indoor pool, with the studio that we freaking love too. But it was just something that was so surreal with us getting up in the morning and laughing and being in that close, confined farmhouse. It just made good for this album, I think. It's very special.
Well, I guess that really attributes to why you guys write so much music together and how quickly you do it, is because you just seem to be genuinely having a good time with each other while you're doing it, you know?
And... Oh, yeah, it's fun. Oh, it's fun. And then, like, when we get to Elvis's place, so check it out. It's like this. I can sing in 4 different settings. So once we get there, now it's like, all right, we have a band, a live room that we set up in, and then we're going in there, we're writing new music. Like, all right, let's get it. Let's pre-production. We're rocking these songs out, and Elvis is right there taking notes, and oh, this is awesome. You know, what are you guys coming up with? And then we move it from there to start going in, and who's going to go first? Maybe it'd be Morgan's doing his drums. So Morgan's recording his drums, and they're tracking in the main room. Well, guess what? Now John has a studio set up where he's doing guitars and vocals, and then Clint's up somewhere. And so I'm able to kind of do a beehive certain time. I think, well, what you working on up here, Clint? Well, I had this idea. And so I'll go upstairs with Clint. What time are you going to get together? Let's get together about 10:30. Okay, bam, I'll be up there. I'll work with you about 2 hours. Bam, John, what time are you get together? Bam, I'll run back downstairs. Now I'm in the studio with John. So it's like this... And we all get to, and it's, man, it's such a cool working experience. I feel like a bee in a beehive when we work with Sevendust.
And I always say this, but I personally believe that the hardest thing to do in music is to develop your own signature sound. You know, mm-hmm. Something that's so easily recognizable. You know exactly what you're listening to after a couple bars. And Sevendust is definitely in that realm. You know, from the very start through Truth Killer, it's clear you guys have this chemistry and formula that generates the sound that we know. Sevendust. And you know, I'm curious, was there a point in the early years where you guys were messing around with various things, various sounds, and stumbled onto something unique? Or was it kind of like this eureka moment that, you know, led to what we know as the sound today?
Man, I believe the first time we got together, we wrote the song Black. That was a magic thing. We were in the rec room in a place that we were like, how are we going to pay the bills to this? Oh, we have to play here. Hopefully they'll book us to pay the rent to play. And so we got together and we wrote Black, and we had a song called Crazy that I had from another band that I brought to Sevendust. We weren't Sevendust then. We were so excited, and we knew that we had something good. Let me tell you, my friend, we went to a famous bar called Charlie Magruder's in Atlanta, and everyone kind of had a buzz about us because they knew it was Morgan, which these guys are older, Clint, and I was a young guy that they kind of found. And they all knew about Sevendust, and they let us play at Charlie McGrew's, and we only had 2 songs, Black and Crazy. And we went up there and we played those songs hard, and we played anything. And right then we knew we had something, because they said, guys, we know you only have 2 songs. They loved it. Get up there and do it again. And we went up there, we made it, rotated at Denver, but we jammed them songs again. And from then on, we went back in and said, this is the band, and we knew we had something. And that's a true story. We could play those songs all night long, and maybe a cover.
Right. Oh, that's amazing, man. So it was just like that. You had that chemistry, you know?
Oh, yeah, it was that chemistry, man. When we showed up, and I remember having an apartment, and we wrote a song in a sandbox. Me and Clint were hanging out, and I was like, man, this is going to be special. And I see this being something. Look at us now, 30 something, 25 something years later, that we're still doing it, you know, still meeting up and getting ready to embark on a new tour with a new album coming out with a new label, which I'm thankful for. Man, I forgot about the days. I'm like, some people, we got to, we're going to sign them. Hold on, wait a second, put some ink on this. I got to sign this. What's going to happen? Is this going to be another thing where it's just like, oh, we signed a record deal and we're going to make sure that you play with bands that are on our label? No, this is completely different. Napalm's already put behind four videos that people still haven't seen. Doing more interviews and press international, talking to the biggest magazine press in the world, talking to you. It's like, obviously there's something different that's going on with these people being behind us, which I feel like is something that's been needed with Sevendust, with us doing things by ourselves and then signing with, you know, who we signed with. It just didn't happen the way. And I feel like with this venture, it's already showing that a lot of things are different.
Yeah. I mean, that must be like kind of a weird situation and, you know, mentally, just to like 30 years in, it still feels new, you know, like to, oh, like, man. Oh man, we're starting over with new label, new this, new that.
It feels new. You know, last time, you know, man, I can't say anything about what happened. It was bad. The pandemic was just bad on everybody. We released the album, Blood and Stone, which was incredible. I think, man, that album didn't get its due because we didn't get to freaking tour it because of the pandemic.
It was a great record, yes.
Thank you. And I, you know, those things happen in life. So I just feel like we're going to hit the ground running. And you just said, it's like a new beginning. It's like, I feel with that last tour we did with Alter Bridge, maybe it's because everyone has been locked up for so long, but it has this certain youth energy. It's contagious, not the same type of contagious, but a new contagious energy where they're there early. They're there again at like 9 o'clock in the morning outside the bus. No, we ain't playing until 10 o'clock. What you doing? But they're excited and we come out and hang out with everybody. It's that feeling of being kids again. You know what I mean? Because everyone's been so worried about what's going to happen next in life. That 45 minutes or hour that we're on the stage is that serenity where we don't worry about our wives fussing at us or our boyfriends or whoever your significant other or the bills at home. We're just here for music because I feel music is a medicine. And I ain't nothing but trying to be a doctor and give it to you.
Right. It's amazing. Amazing sentiment. I mean, 14 records later, I mean, that is a ton of work, a lot of words, a lot of riffs. Do you find it more challenging as you go to develop new music and new concepts to write about?
No, not when you have. Maybe if I had been that, you know, not now. I feel like because the kids, the wives, the things that we see in life, everything, there's something to write about. My experiences of being a Black man as a 50-year-old in the world, to see how things are regressing in the climate and the heat in situations where I'm in, I'm like, I can't believe that I just walked in this place and I feel awkward, if that might be the word. You know what I mean? And I feel like those type of things, life continues to give you something to write about as long as you're in it. You know what I mean? As long as you're walking in the worldly world, you're going to see worldly things. And we cannot not be in it with the jobs that we're in. We're always amongst it. We're always amongst different types of people. We're always amongst opinions. I feel like we meet more people, like you traveling, we meet more people than the normal people meet. You know what I mean? So we come across more individuals in different settings and maybe this one guy from this podunk town that ain't never been nowhere and gets to see Sevendust for the first time. He don't know nothing else but about where he's from. You know what I mean? So then it's so to me, it's just, I'm able to write about every situation and there's always a situation to write about. Even if it's like, what am I write about? I never go into it like that. The song never moves me like that. I don't go in like, I'm old school. I got to put this in and I let the song move me. And then if it just happens to be, you know, shoot, might be something walking down the street that might spark it. You know what I mean? That old lady that I just met that I gave a dollar to help her. Like I remember being in Atlanta the other day and seeing this old lady going, a China walk or something. And the tour bus, we were getting ready to leave the next day. It started the Archer Bridge tour. And this lady walked up with this kid that looked like he was 15. It could have been the grandkid, but he walked in with her to the shop and to eat food. And I saw him talking to her and I was just kind of looking at her. She could tell she looked like she was homeless, but but I didn't know the situation. I didn't want to be weird. And I just remember, I don't know, maybe it's because I'm older, just being teary-eyed when she said, I'm okay, baby. I got everything I need. She said, you can go home. And she's sitting there. So I'm waiting on my food. And I'm like, this is crazy. And I look over at her and she's digging in her socks, bro. Change is falling out and she's trying to get it. And she's standing there. And I just went over to her and I grabbed her arm. I was like, what you doing? And she's like, I'm just trying to get some money. I'm going to get me some food. I'm like, what you want? And she's like, I'm just going to get the. And she said what she wanted. And I said, you sit down. And I said, you put your socks back on. And she's like, I can sit down. I was like, yes, ma'am. I'm going to cry. Woo. So she sat down. I bought her food, whatever. But life like that, not knowing what she was doing in her life. I'm sorry.
No, man.
Damn, I didn't think I was going to cry.
That's a beautiful, beautiful sentiment.
So those things that I write about, you know. Anyway, I'm good now. Yeah. That was just, yeah, I'm sorry, man. I just thought about that. She was so beautiful, man. And she was just like, thank you so much. And I was like, oh, my God. What is she going through in this life? And I'm getting ready to get on this fucking tour bus and tour the world. I'm so blessed.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. I think it's really important to take a moment of gratitude in everything that we do. I try to do that, you know, through meditation, you know, as much as I can as well. And like, it truly is like for every big complaint that we have out there, there's some people so much worse. And, you know, it's wild.
Thank you for understanding that, man. I'm sorry. I didn't think I was.
No. I appreciate you saying that and sharing that.
I went back to the bus crying. I'm like, oh, my God, guys, guess what? They're like, what's wrong with you? I'm like, oh, my God. You don't know what happened. It was so real and just so innocent and just like, God dang it, man. We're so lucky to be where we're at all, you know, just us, you know.
Yeah,
that's all.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I mean, you have a lot to be grateful for.
Yes, sir.
Like I said, you know, another great record and under your belt, 14 records later, almost 30 years now.
Woo!
I mean, of course.
I'm talking to you. You're the biggest in the world. What are you talking about?
I mean, it's such an eye-opening experience, you know, that your life that touches on the lives of all the members as a group and even personally. What do you think that you learned about yourself in that time?
Man, that sorry's not enough. That everything gets better with time. We were at a situation in our lives where seven of us almost stopped because we're going to go bankrupt because we had so many people in our pockets. And I don't say fans, the family out there is what kept us going. Without people being interested in us, we wouldn't have a job, because at the end of the day, if they stopped, then no one would care. So that's what's important, is like that family of people that have been our supporters for this long has kept us afloat. You know, we've been in that boat and we've been like throwing water out of that motherfucker for sure. But you know what? We've been here and we're still here. And I feel like, once you said, it's a new beginning for us right now. So it ain't no time for us to stop. I feel like 50 for me is the new 30. So get ready for me to kick some more ass for a long time.
Awesome. I love that. I remember reading somewhere years ago that you started your music career in a soul group. Is that right?
Yeah. Well, Body and Soul was more of a funk band, but before that, I did R&B stuff, man. I was, you know, I was working with some R&B acts, but it never really went anywhere. But I was able to, they felt I was a good enough singer. And I was around like the Motown group. I wrote with the band. I mean, this might be too far away from our genre, but I remember writing with the group ABC, Another Bad Creation, Aisha, from Belle Biv DeVoe's group, all those, that Motown group. Back in the day, I was in the studio writing with them. And so I've been around it for a long time. So I'm so very happy that in Sevendust, I'm able to bring every element of my upgrowing, my root, my from my dad's disco rock band, soul band, to my countryside, and it's all there. I feel like I'm able to put all my elements of music in the Sevendust, and people understand it.
Do you still keep up with like the soul and disco and stuff?
Oh man, yeah, you should hear my new solo stuff. Woo, it's all good. I've been working on that that's another thing. I wanted to get off the subject of that. But yeah, I've been working on solo stuff. I'll be going back to Nashville in July to finish up some songs. It's so funny that we're talking. I did several songs, and this is an accident. I just got back home, and I was in my closet, and I was like, oh, my God, what time do I have to do this? Took a shower, threw this shirt on. This is who I've been writing with. You remember the band Raw?
I do, yeah.
Tahaj is one of my best buddies, and this is his shirt. So I got to take a picture of me and you and say that we're doing press with the Raw shirt.
Awesome.
That's all. Yeah, but man, I'm doing my solo stuff, and I've been working with a crew out in Nashville, Tennessee. They're some of the main writers for Jelly Roll's past big album, and I've been working with a group called the Four Horsemen. I probably have about 20 solo songs that go from rock to country to everything. That's all in me, and I can't wait to share that with people too.
That's amazing, man. So what? How did that go? Like, I mean, you're into disco, soul, and everything else, and R&B. So what? How did you find metal? At what point did that happen?
Maybe when I was, well, I always grew up with around metal. I mean, like going to the farm was different than being at, like, sorry. So say being at the house was always R&B and like a little rock. Yeah, I consider, you know, whatever rock bands my dad was listening to at that time. But then I would go to the farm for summer and it'd be nothing but country music and rock and roll blasting through the farmhouse. And so that's why I grew up on that. And then my dad being in a disco band, there was never a time where they were like, you can't listen to that music or something like that. It was always, we love music, let's listen to it. We go to my dad's house and I remember listening to Spanish music and not understanding a word, but loving it and being like, I don't know why I love this so much, but because it was the meaning behind it. It was the conviction that you felt in the voices, the song, the element. And that's what I still believe to this day. And that's why in my house, from every floor, there's a different kind of music playing and it's always around. Music to me is, this world would be even crazier without song and melody. You know what I mean? It would be, think about how crazy it would be. It's crazy now, but without that, I don't know what we would do, you know? Yeah.
No, I think everybody would go crazy.
Crazier. It was like, sing a song, man. And music to me is so awesome. And I've been doing these interviews and people talk to me and they're like, man, and you forget as an artist sometimes that some of those songs put you back in a time in your life where it might help you get through a time in your life now. You know what I mean? Just because of that whatever that energy that music put through is going back through you again and making you move forward through now. And I just say, like I said, music is a healer for sure.
Yeah, in every way. It's also a universal language, you know? I mean,
yeah, like, absolutely.
Like, you know, as somebody who travels as I do, like, I mean, you get to meet so many different people from around the world and with so many different language backgrounds and barriers, but your music is that one thing that will
universal.
Break all those barriers down, you know?
Absolutely. So, man, you say you lived in Brazil. So, for whatever reason, my heart is in Brazil for some reason. I have Brazilian friends that bring me food from Brazil. I forget this one thing that's in my cover right now, but it's like a Reese's, but it's not a Reese's. It starts with a P.
Pachoca?
Oh, God, yeah. I just said it starts with a P. You said it.
Yeah, dude, I ate like a million of those things. I fucking love them.
You can go to my house right now, and I have a crate of it. But, oh, wow, that's so funny. And the fig stuff that they have, I get that sent to me. But just on the listening party, a couple flew over from Brazil and hung out with us for that week. And it's so amazing. What was it like for you in Brazil, man?
Fuck, I loved it. I went everywhere. Sao Paulo, Rio, Buenos Aires. I ended my trip, actually, for a week and a half in the Amazon rainforest. And
no was, way.
Yeah, so it was like one of those things. And, you know, I took a one-way flight out to Brazil.
So you're
going
to stay?
Yeah, I didn't know. Like, I mean, how I live life, I kind of just roll with it and see, you know, what happens and figure it
That's
out from
amazing.
There. You know,
right.
meet locals and kind of go about it from there.
Wow.
So I wound up in the Amazon rainforest, and that was fucking like once-in-a-lifetime amazing type thing. You know, like, I mean, you don't just stumble there. Like, you have to.
You have to be there.
Yeah, you have. Like, it's like a five-hour flight away. It's
when
in the
you
middle
show
of,
up, they know you're there for a reason. It's like,
of course, right, yeah. Yeah, you know, like, I don't speak
the
language. Yeah.
He's legit, obviously.
It was awesome.
Man, what was it like? All right, so you got to see the Statue of Jesus. Is that Rio?
Yep, yeah, yeah. I took my drone out. I hiked it early in the morning at like 4 a.m. just to see the sunrise around there before all the people. Because it's, you know, very touristy. There's a ton of people out there. So the best way to see it for me is really anything is to... undisturbed, you know, like I love
That's
to be there the first person there when something opens or even before it opens.
Like me, I'll be on my lake tomorrow on our new Sea-Doos at 5 a.m. when no one else is out there. Now tell me, how big was it when you were there as to the size of the statue?
It's huge. It's massive. Yeah. It's already at the top of the one of the tallest mountains, and then you're
was
there.
Was it scary?
No. I mean, well, no. I'm not afraid of heights like that. So for somebody who is, maybe, you know.
Yeah, it would be a little bit scary. I mean, I don't know. It's just still so. Thank you for sharing that, man. I've never talked to anyone that's, well, of course, my Brazilian friends, but anyone that's been over there, just tell me what it's like to see it, man. I can't wait to get over there. The food, the people, everything seems so festive and just, yeah, you know, even though I'm sure the poor parts are the poor parts, but it's the culture is what I.
Have you guys never played there before?
No, I can't believe it.
Okay, I'm gonna put you in touch with somebody. Actually, well, let's get back into the Sevendust stuff.
Sorry.
But you know, but I wanted to know, you know, is there anything, you know, with that you did with Truth Killer that you try different than other albums when writing?
Yeah, I think we went in and we kind of went more electronic. It's cool. Like I feel like Clint really got to dig deep into that Nine Inch Nail side of him with like a song, Might Let the Devil Win. I think we weren't afraid for me. To be even more melodic on this album with vocals. I feel that we've done all the heavy stuff for years and years and years, and it's a good time for us to show a different side of Sevendust. And with this label, we were able to do it too. And we're not afraid. We've not been afraid ever, but I feel like it's just a good time for us to have an album like this out right now. I feel like it's mature and it shows a side of us that's grown as artists and musicians.
Awesome. Well, it's a fantastic record, and
thank you.
Yeah, I invite everyone watching to go pick it up out this July. Truth Killer, Lajon, thank you so much for hanging with me, and I'll see you on the road. I know you're gonna hit the road,
sir.
Real hard this year.
Yeah, thank you, brother, and you have safe travels. And it was a pleasure to talk to you. Your energy is magic, and you definitely are an ambassador of music, my brother. Thank you, bro.
Thank you, man. I appreciate that.